Queen Faculty of Education, Dr. Pupung Puspardini, MPD, who have helped to make this event possible, and also the head of Early Childhood Education Program, Dr. Setio Utoyo, MPD, who will join us later. And for this special event, I also want to thank my friend, Sue Sit Lim, or Cindy Lim, you can call her Miss Cindy, to give us time for today with the with all her hectic schedule. So thank you very much, Cindy, to share your experiences as a kindergarten teacher in Singapore. Mm-hmm. And before I start, I'm going to introduce Cindy to you all. Jadi sebelum kita mulai, saya akan memperkenalkan Cindy, yaitu speaker kita atau pemateri kita pada sore hari ini. Di tengah kesibukannya, menyempatkan waktu untuk memberikan kita waktu untuk sharing ya, tentang bagaimana sih sebagai seorang guru PAUD di Singapura itu, apa yang harus dilakukan. Well, Cindy, Yes, you're currently work at the Carpe Diem Preschool, is that right?
Yes, Carpe Diem Preschool, which is run with a whole so-called it's a franchising, but their program is slightly different from the government's kindergarten. But we are also part of the framework with the government kindergarten, same, but it's a different way of conduct in the theory and practical.
Yes. Yeah. Interesting. And before in this school, you work at the Chatsworth International Preschool.
Yes.
Yeah. And from 2018 to present, you also become an English teacher.
Yes.
For teaching lessons that included planning curriculums and daily activities.
Yeah.
And yeah, from 2007 to 2014, you also work as a volunteer with Very Special Art, a non-profit. Yes. To assist our children, our teachers, I mean, with autism children in Singapore.
Yep.
Very wonderful. And before being an educator, you work in banking and financial institutions. Yes. As a project manager who led multiple projects with global and local organizations. Wonderful. And also your educational background from 2016 to 2017, you graduate from Master of Early Years at Queensland University of Technology in Brisbane, Australia. Mm-hmm. And from 2000 to 2002, you also Master of Business Administrative, majoring in International Management from RMIT, Royal Melbourne Institute, I think, something like that. And I think you did your bachelor in United Kingdom, is that right?
Yes, I did a business computing study as a science degree in the City University London for 2 years, in 1995 to 1997. Where I lived there and then study full time there, and then after that I come back to Singapore, continue my career as the business analyst consultant, and then growing on with the project managers from there until 2015. Yeah.
Yeah, you all are over the world. I think sudah banyak negara ya menyelesaikan Inggris.
Yes.
Kemudian S2 di Australia, setelah itu bekerja di Singapura. Kemudian banyak melakukan kegiatan volunteering dengan anak-anak berkebutuhan khusus, dan sekarang terjun ke dunia pendidikan anak usia dini. Luar biasa, very amazing ya. Well, without further ado, it's time to welcome Cindy to give presentation. Cindy, please, time is yours.
I will share you a PowerPoint to go through. Do feel free to stop me if I'm going too fast about what I would like to share with you. Basically, it's why I put diversity preschool practice in Singapore. Because Singapore, as we have three races, which is Malay, Chinese, and Indian. So Also, we have a migrant children, so that's why I will put diversity preschool practice. We are not only focused for the local children, we also focus for the foreign kids. So further to that, I will go into details. During the curriculum planning in a preschool, which I have encountered, we focus on integrations in multi-intelligency preschool. What do I mean by multi-intelligency? I will go through in details, which are those multi-intelligency we are talking about, which is quite similar to all the other countries, but we are splitting into 8 intelligency from 6, which is required by the local government educator. Then we'll talk about collaboration theory and practice in preschool, pedagogy in preschool. So why I put it theory and practice? Because what we learn in theory, sometimes is not fully applied in practice, or practice will be more feasible day-to-day activity. Theory is the back-end support to us in a way. And I will take why this integration theory and practice benefit to the children daily activity that is planned in the curriculum in the preschool. So at the kindergarten program, as all the countries similarly, we also have a literacy program, which is a language. Many is English. We do have a Chinese language. It's a second language. So for the preschool children here, we have two languages they learn, mainly English and the Chinese. So for me, I'm an English teacher. Then we will have one partner Chinese teacher who will teach the children with a similar activity, but they are focused in a different directions. And the same thing, we have a maths and science program. And for the kindergarten, which is 5 years and 4 years, 5 year and 6 year kids, now we do have so-called a project approach. We're integrating the maths and science to develop children in understanding what will happen in the real life. Not only every day we talk about theory teaching them. Then arts program. Arts program is very getting important for children to be more creative, to learn to draw, to learn to make 2D artworks or 3D artworks. So that is help the children think beyond what they have seen and also go out of the box. And lastly, we also focus on characters building program, which is getting important to build the children's characters, meaning that our social emotional development that is come into part of that. So for this program, where it will bring into a multi-intelligency to most of the preschool, but to the local government school, we all have 6 intelligency. What a difference, actually it's not different, yeah? So if we look into this diagram, multi-intelligencies, first, we have a language. The language play important part in a speak and drama. We have a role play, storytelling to the children, and we also have a visuals and music. So in the activity every day in my program through the week, we do have a music in one day, so-called music with the instrument or singing song or dancing. Then we do have a role play, meaning that through the storytelling, we will show the children use a plot or use the action that teacher will get the children participate to learn to speak, to learn what is a communication engagement among the children. Then also we use a music to help children to sing along, to learn the language from them. So that is part language I embedded in this. Another part is numeracy and maths. So we don't see that numeracy and maths is only one activity in the lesson plan. We also embedded in manipulative block play. What do we mean? We have a block or a 3-dimensional shapes or any shapes. We get children to make it up. A house, a car, a train. So from there, that is part of the vision of the numeracy and maths to the children. From there, we also teach children to learn a positioning, like first, second, third, fourth, to up to 10. On top of that, we also teach them into additions and subtractions. Addition subtractions is come into age 4 and 5. But to the manipulative block and number recognition, number 1 to 10, 1 to 100, that is from 2.5 years up to 6 years old. So So that is constantly we have applied that. So that is one of the multiple intelligence that we're talking about. Then we move on to the physical development. Physical development is split into two. We have fine motor skill and gross motor skill. So we need the children to develop physically to focus running, jumping, roll, hand roll ball, throwing. That will build their physical and strong to their brain development. And fine motor, gross motor skill is that sensory. We like them to touch the sand, let them to touch the glue, let them to touch the painting. That will embed with the visuals of arts come into pictures. So that is where is that the integration of the intelligence come about. And lastly, social emotion is very important. That is helped to build the characters of the children. And we develop into two, where internal and interpersonal and intrapersonal. What is the difference between interpersonal and intrapersonal? Interpersonal is how they communicate with the friends. For example, how they work, play with a friend, how they share the toys, how they fix the puzzle together, how they have a role play. That is all come together with integrations for the interpersonal. And that will bring into the language, speaking, role play, and then they also bring into the numeracy when they make the manipulative with the block play. And then they also came into the point that we have a project base. So I will bring into the project base later. That is overall that required to involve this multi-intelligency. Now, the other last part is intrapersonal. Intrapersonal is more on children's speech, courage, willing to learn to be polite, willing to learn to be admit their mistake, say sorry, and then willing to be accept others, children surrounding them. As I said, mentioned earlier on, we have three races, Chinese, Malay, Indian. So in the class, we do have three races children. On other country, other school, like I have in previous school, international school, I do have a Russian kid. So the children in Singapore, they hardly meet with other kids. They will have, why are these kids with a golden hair, white skin, and the speech accent is different. So there is where the interpersonal skill for them to be able to accept the culture differences, and they're willing to speak it up, and they're willing to learn from others. So that is all, I would say, that multi-intelligency. So totality itself, we have 8 for some preschool, for my preschool. If for the local government school, we have 6. Why? Because they put social emotional is 1, where else for others, we split into 2. So that is extra 1. And for the physical development, we split into 5 and gross. For the government, it's only put into 1 physical. That's why it becomes 6 instead of totally 8. Yeah. So I will stop here if any questions before I move on.
Coba tanya berapa uang dipakai kalau mau pulang.
Before you move on, explain in bahasa so they can understand.
Yeah, let them digest a bit.
And they want to ask questions.
Yes, correct.
Ya, jadi tadi Miss Cindy sudah menjelaskan luar biasa ya, dengan sangat detail dan juga dengan sangat lengkap tentang bagaimana sih pembelajaran di Singapura itu. Jadi dimulai dari kata diversity atau kata keanekaragaman lah, atau apa namanya, bisa kita dibilang bersatu dalam perbedaan seperti itu. Jadi seperti diketahui bahwa di Singapura itu etnisnya sangat beragam ya, mulai dari orang Chinese, kemudian ada etnis Melayu, dan juga ada etnis India, itu mayoritas yang menjadi penduduk di sana. Di samping itu juga banyak anak-anak yang berasal dari lebih diverse ya, dari internasional, ada yang dari Rusia tadi disebutkan. Jadi memang di sana diversity atau keberagaman itu sangat menjadi poin penting untuk di sekolah ya, begitu. Nah, dan di sekolah di Singapura juga itu sangat memfokuskan pada kecerdasan majemuk atau biasa kita kenal dengan multiple intelligence. Jadi bagaimana semua kecerdasan ini bisa dimasukkan ke dalam pembelajaran. Misalnya setiap minggu mereka mengadakan role play atau drama di mana anak dituntut untuk mengintegrasikan aspek-aspek perkembangan yang ada, misalnya saja aspek perkembangan bahasa. Jadi dengan adanya role play atau drama ini, mereka dituntut untuk dapat menggunakan kosakata atau kata-kata yang baik dan benar. Kemudian ada juga di situ kelas untuk musik, di mana anak diberikan keberanian untuk tampil dan misalnya mau belajar bahasa asing ya, mereka bisa menggunakan musik atau lagu yang ada di sekolah tersebut. Jadi program-programnya juga seperti program literasi. Literasi itu anak di sana mereka menggunakan dua bahasa ya. Tadi disebutkan yang pertama itu bahasa Inggris, yang kedua itu di sekolah sendiri bahasa Cina. Jadi dua bahasa itu digunakan. Jadi ada guru masing-masing untuk setiap bahasa yang akan diajarkan. Kemudian untuk program matematika ya atau numerasi, mereka berbasis proyek. Jadi pendekatannya itu proyek. Jadi proyeknya itu sangat dikaitkan dengan apa yang terjadi pada kehidupan anak sehari-harinya begitu. Nah, kemudian bagian art atau seni tadi, anak dituntut untuk bisa lebih kreatif. Jadi mereka bisa melihat apa, melakukan aktivitas dari apa yang mereka lihat, kemudian mengkombinasikan dengan imajinasi. Nah, kemudian untuk social emotional development tadi disebutkan bahwa ada intrapersonal dan interpersonal. Jadi itu seperti yang kita pelajari di multiple intelligence atau di kecerdasan majemuk, semua pasti sudah mengetahui ya beberapa jenis kecerdasan majemuk. Nah, jadi kemudian di sekolahnya Cindy juga seperti tadi disebutkan bahwa karena banyaknya keanekaragaman di situ, jadi anak dituntut untuk saling bertoleransi. Jadi karena di sekolah itu mungkin ada anak dengan warna kulit yang berbeda, sangat jauh berbeda, kemudian ada anak dengan logat atau dialek yang jauh berbeda dari teman-temannya, itu semua mereka diberikan awareness atau kesadaran tentang bahwa di dunia ini atau banyak sekali perbedaan-perbedaan yang ada, tetapi semua itu bagian hal yang penting dan harus dihargai atau di nah, kalau kalian ingin partisipan ingin bertanya tentang Cindy sebelum ini, silakan bisa ditulis pertanyaannya di chat atau nanti bisa menekan tombol raise hand. Jadi nanti kita akan berikan kesempatan untuk bertanya langsung ke Cindy. Please Cindy continue your explanation. I think I already explained to them.
Alright, thank you. So I will further ado. The more important aspect is inclusive. Why I bring inclusive? As we know, we used to call special needs, but in the world now, a lot of children have come with different culture and behavior and social emotional issue. So what we say that when I was doing the many years ago, 2007. And 2014, I involved with a special needs school on arts, in a very special arts. That is where I realized that a lot of children have autism, meaning that they are not fully disability, but they do have a function of speech, hearing impairment, hand sensory. So that is where it's one part. To the group of populations in the country, to the world, not only to Singapore, there is also the children grown up have hyperactive functions, focusing loss, and they do also have a family issue where their learning behavioral is slow, behavioral with not being listened as a call, not a good child. But in reality, we don't classify them. So in most of the kindergarten school in Singapore, in fact, when I working in Australia part-time voluntary, there is a lot of children combined with a different behavior issue in the class. So that's why in Singapore, we also have that even in my school, in my class also. They are smart, intelligent in the number, in the languages, but they have a tendency cannot sit still. They're very hyperactive running about. They have a tendency of throwing a tantrum. They have tendency of cannot focus, or their hearing is not there. And they want to talk, but they're slow in speech. So some of them is a learning slowness in speech. And some of them is very parents use into too many technology, iPad, smartphone, that has resulted children grow in the slow and not focusing mind. And we that when they go to diagnose to the hospital, they will say that they are classified under autism, but in reality, they may not be. So that's why I say why we put it as inclusiveness. So that is where it becomes an important topic. When we as an educator, we don't learn much from our theory, physics, in what we learn in school. But what we also only learn that this children behavior is very kind of a bad behavior, playful, naughty. But in reality, they could be classified a lot. So when it comes to practical, we need to base on our observation as a teacher. We look at the children, why they behave like that, why they fight with a friend, why they are not listening to the teacher, why they can't sit still. So a lot of practical bring in, then we will reflect our theory, what we learn. Then from there, we are collaboration, integrate how to help to improve a child, emotional, behavioral. That is where I brought in the topic of social emotional development, inter and intra personal skill that involved. Yeah. So as that is a very a lot challenge. As in a lot of university, they bring in the subject for special needs. Yes, special needs, as we learn, could be physical disability. It could be a social emotional issue, speech impairment, or hearing impairment. So that is where we need to be more focused what we are talking about when you look at the child. The other thing I would like to bring in at the leadership. Why I talk at the leadership? I myself am the project manager for many years, and I was a manager, manage a team. I see a different culture, people, different way of manage people, different society issue, different social communication. So if bring into an educator and look at the principal, look at the leader in the school, that has become a very important aspect as a leader. So as a teacher, we teacher also consider leader to the children. So let me bring into two aspects. One, leader as a teacher in the classroom to the teacher, to the children. We are the role model to the children, okay? Role model, what do we mean? Is that what we do, what we speak, children will learn, children will reflect to us. So we have to be very mindful what we want to talk to the children, what we want to bring up the children to a good future children that we are wanted them to be. The other aspect I look at it is the principal itself, as a senior teachers. How the interaction between senior teacher and the teachers among in the school. That will also influence how the teachers communicate to the children, because their children also look at how we teacher communicate among ourselves. So that is also another aspect as the teachers in the educator for the preschool. Always remember, I always tell the teachers in my school that what the monkey see, what the monkey do. In other words, that children see what we do, they will follow. And we will not see it immediately. Along the way, I have seen that some children, along the way, the parents say, oh, my child go back and tell me that how they have, children have a role play with them. How the children interact with how the teacher interact with the children. So I will take a step back. Oh, then I had to be mindful of my own behavior as a teacher when I talk to children. Yes, sometimes we are very angry to scold the children. Sometimes we try to use a corner timeout, a punishment to them, 3 minutes, 2 minutes. But we need to be mindful for the reason why we punish them, why we want to scold the children. For me as a teacher, for me as a leader, I always will give a reason to tell the children why I punish them, why I scold them, why I want them to behave like this, why I want them to be good. So from that, when we scold the children, when we tell the children they shouldn't do it, they should do that, they will be able to understand what is the purpose for them. At the traditional way of a family, as a teacher, I know that a lot of teachers scold and punish, but not given a reason why. So another children will be kind of do not understand why, become the internal fear to them. So another that we will come to the point of social emotional development. Some children will hold back. They were not willing to talk to teacher. They were not willing to express their feeling to the parents. And some, I have a kids that don't have enough love for parents of those who have social issue in the family. They are not get enough attention. When they come to school, they will have have anger with them. So we as the teachers, we must know how to lead them, how to get them to talk as a role model to the children. And that will bring me to the collaboration. The collaboration is parents and the teacher is very important. Nowadays, to me that we have learned theory itself, collaboration, parents and teacher is very important. How? How do we apply that? A lot of time theory doesn't tell us how do we apply that. Open communication, yes, they also say open communication. How much open communication are we going to be open? How truthfully are we going to tell the parents about your child? How much the parent want to hear from teachers? Good, bad, or both? So there is a lot of challenge from that. Some parents willing to accept their children witness because they see that their children witness and they could not teach their children how to help to develop their children. That is where the communication with parents and teachers is very important. But some parents only want to hear my child, good behavior, good thing, good academic. That is a huge challenge because smart child, they have their own behavioral issue. They do not willing to share. They have the pride themselves. I'm better than anybody. I do not want to listen to the friend. I do see that in my child, to the student. When the children, when I read the storybook, I ask that question. One kid will give a talk, the response. The other kid will just turn away and do something else. So why? Is the children not interested? Or the children think that they know, they don't want to hear. So I ever ask a child, do you think you know you don't want to hear? There can be way that look at their face, they could be respond, yes, I know already, why do I need to know? No, I always told the kids, you must learn from other friends, although you know. So that is where the collaboration with the kids and the teachers and the parents and the teacher come into the picture. Why? Because the parents also will share the information with the kids. Overwhelming, the children become very smart. But when they come to school, they already know. I don't need to know. So when I talk to the parents, I say, yes, when you all share information, do use a questions, asking them why, what, how, when. That will prompt them to think. And when they accept information, they come to the class, they will just share. But they forgot to ask the question. Become creative thinking is important. So where is the collaboration coming? Yeah. And that is where I say collaboration is teacher and parents, teacher and children in the engagement part. And a lot of time come into a role play model and the project that we have embarked in the preschool over here. All right. I think I'd like you to have open up any question or let you time to give translation to your colleague and teach student.
Okay, thank you so much, Cindy. Very insightful explanation. Mm-hmm. And now I'm going to translate for the audience so they can get more focus, more picture about what we are talking today and maybe ask some question to you. Well, jadi tadi yang Cindy sebutkan bahwa, Miss Cindy sebutkan dalam penjelasan yang berikutnya bahwa dalam pendidikan anak usia dini itu kita harus menemukan aspek inklusif. Apa itu aspek inklusif? Aspek di mana kita bisa menerima atau kita bisa memahami bahwa setiap anak itu berbeda. Mulai dari budaya yang berbeda, mulai dari latar belakang yang berbeda, mulai dari kemampuan yang berbeda, dan setiap anak itu unik dengan perbedaannya masing-masing. Jadi hal menjadi inklusif atau mengikutkan semua anak dengan berbagai macam perbedaan yang mereka miliki itu merupakan hal penting di mana kita sebagai guru melihat kebutuhan tiap-tiap anak ini dan memang berusaha untuk memfasilitasi secara maksimal khususnya di PAUD itu tumbuh kembangnya ya. Nah, kemudian seperti tadi Cindy mengatakan bahwa di pengalamannya sebagai volunteer selama beberapa tahun telah membantu dia untuk dapat memahami anak dengan berbagai persoalan yang, atau mungkin berbagai karakter yang berbeda. Contohnya salah satu anak dengan latar belakang yang memiliki autis ya, bagaimana mereka berpikir, bagaimana mereka bereaksi, dan bagaimana kita sebagai guru memberikan reaksi yang tepat ke anak tersebut, itu hal-hal yang memang perlu dipelajari. Dan Cindy juga mengatakan bahwa di samping teori yang kita dapatkan dari perkuliahan, dari universitas, kita juga harus membuka diri untuk lebih banyak melihat sekeliling kita, prakteknya di lapangan, seperti itu. Misalnya, kita kan banyak kegiatan yang mengharuskan mahasiswa ke sekolah atau mahasiswa berkunjung ke suatu tempat. Disitulah kesempatan-kesempatan bagi kita untuk mencocokkan apa sih teori yang saya pelajari di universitas ini cocok dengan apa yang muncul di lapangan, misalnya gitu, di sekolah tempat saya observasi. Jadi itu semua proses kita untuk menemukan model pembelajaran atau menemukan cara membantu anak dengan lebih maksimal. Kemudian saat ini tantangan guru, kita lihat banyak anak yang mungkin pintar dalam hal bahasa, matematika, dan sebagainya, tetapi kesulitan untuk fokus atau kesulitan untuk mendengarkan apa yang disebutkan. Nah, Cindy mengatakan bahwa mungkin salah satu penyebabnya itu karena kelebihan waktu yang digunakan atau banyaknya waktu yang digunakan dengan teknologi. Jadi dia kesulitan untuk fokus dengan interaksi dengan orang lain, seperti itu. Nah, kemudian tadi sudah disebutkan bahwa salah satu hal penting lagi ada leadership atau kepemimpinan. Nah, kepemimpinan kita ini juga memang sangat dipengaruhi oleh banyak faktor, seperti faktor budaya, pengalaman, dan bagaimana model komunikasi kita kepada orang sekeliling kita. Dan perlu dipahami bahwa yang dimaksud pemimpin di sini bukan cuma kayak kepala sekolah atau ketua yayasan, tetapi guru sendiri itu merupakan pemimpin. Pemimpin bagi murid-muridnya, role model atau contoh untuk anaknya. Jadi apa yang guru katakan, lakukan, atau perlihatkan, itu secara tidak langsung ada cerminan apa yang kita harapkan anak untuk meniru dari kita, seperti itu. Jadi memang kita sebagai guru harus mindful, harus penuh dengan, betul-betul memikirkan apakah yang saya lakukan ini cocok, apakah kalau ditiru anak, apakah kalau dilihat anak akan baik. Jadi itu betul-betul harus dimunculkan dalam diri kita sebagai seorang guru, khususnya guru PAUD ya. Kemudian tadi juga disebutkan bahwa bila kita dalam situasi di mana harus misalnya memberikan pujian atau memberikan hukuman kepada anak, selalu harus memberikan alasan kenapa kita memuji si anak, kenapa kita misalnya menegur si anak, apa yang salah dari anak yang lakukan misalnya. Jadi kita tidak menyerang pribadinya, tapi kita menggarisbawahi, wah hebat ya kamu bisa ini apa misalnya, bisa melakukan apa. Jadi fokus ke apa yang ingin kita beri pujian, apa yang kita ingin misalnya beri peringatan. Misalnya dia berbuat sesuatu yang kurang baik, kita harus dengan jelas mengatakan apa itu misalnya, seperti itu. Nah, kemudian seorang guru juga yang poin terakhir itu kolaborasi ya. Kolaborasi di sini kita pasti berpikir kolaborasi dengan orang tua kan, karena memang orang tua itu penting sekali. Jadi kita sebagai guru memang harus paling tidak punya latar belakang informasi tentang keluarga ini. Kira-kira anak ini kenapa ya seperti ini, apakah perlu saya komunikasikan dengan orang tuanya, dan seberapa terbuka komunikasi yang kita perlukan. Apakah semua hal-hal yang terjadi di sekolah itu perlu kita infokan ke anak, atau mungkin ada orang tua yang cuma mau mendengar hal-hal baiknya saja, atau ada orang tua yang tidak mau kalau gurunya terlalu banyak memberi informasi, khususnya kalau misalnya ada hal yang kurang baik yang terjadi di sekolah. Jadi kadang kita sebagai guru itu punya tantangan sendiri, jadi untuk mengetahui seberapa besar atau seberapa terbuka komunikasi yang kita harus bangun dengan orang tua. Nah, satu hal yang menarik dari Cindy katakan tadi, terkadang kita fokus untuk membangun kolaborasi itu dengan orang dewasa, tapi kita lupa kolaborasi yang paling penting adalah kepada si anak sendiri. Jadi kita kenapa kalau ada sesuatu, kenapa harus tanya orang tua saja? Perlu juga kita tanya anak. Kita tanya anak, misalnya anaknya mungkin kesulitan untuk menjawab, jadi kita lihat ekspresinya. Ekspresinya seperti apa? Terkadang dari ekspresi si anak itu, kita bisa mendapat jawaban atas apa pertanyaan kita. Dan pertanyaan yang mudah kita buat di anak, kepada anak ya, pertanyaan yang memiliki unsur seperti kenapa, apa, bagaimana, kapan, di mana. Jadi suara anak itu perlu dijadikan salah satu landasan dalam mengambil keputusan. Bukan cuma orang tua saja ya, tetapi memang anak sendiri perlu kita tanya dan perlu kita tahu pendapatnya, seperti itu. Nah, bila ada pertanyaan, silahkan di chat atau di bisa raise hand atau mengangkat tangan. Ada
may I ask something?
Okay,
yes. It's very interesting, and I have so many questions for.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, you're going to ask question, please. Yeah.
Maybe it's also for my student. The question is, is there any special strategy during pandemic COVID-19, particularly about inclusiveness? And the second question is, how we stimulate the computational skill with multiple intelligence?
Ah, okay. Yeah. Let me talk about the COVID-19 strategy. When the COVID-19 hit into Singapore, we thought in April 23rd, we have start closing down the preschool for Singapore, inclusive my school. Then we have like kind of 4 weeks later to decide to open, go along with the government. So by the time that government, after 4 weeks, government say, no, we have to have home learning, online learning, Zoom learning, so-called e-learning. So we have conducted e-learning. Yes, it's a challenge to the preschooler children, because it's the first time to them to look at that, you and me. And some, especially as you say, for the parents, most of Singapore parents have a computer. If they don't have computer, you use a smartphone. Yes, internet is everywhere we have. The other challenge part is for the children that parents need to work from home. That is a huge challenge. And the parents have to schedule the time for them to attend. And some parents have a sibling. The child have a sibling. Could be have elder brother, sister. So that is where we have to communicate with the slot time for them. The sibling could be the same age, 1 year different, or could be the primary school or secondary school. We do have that situation. The other main challenge that I have for my class, I have one child, as I say, is hyperactive. He's very good in language. He's very good in maths. But he can't sit still most of the time. He's when we taught in school, physically, he will sit there and listen. He will not responsive most of the time. But when he have a role play, he would like to participate. But online learning, e-learning is hard for them. So I ever seen the mother have to drag him up in the morning, 10 o'clock, 10:30, we start the class. He had to physically sit there and listen. Then he will, whether as a teacher, does he really get what I say through the e-learning or not? Whereas I have other children, they are shy to come to talk. Where in the school, right, face-to-face, he's non-stop talking. So after the whole sessions, first two sessions, then I have a private chat with the mom. The mom say, yes, my child a bit shy, give him some time. And some children will have, oh, I want to talk, but teacher have to go along with other kids' questions, respond. So they will cry. So from there, it's a kind of like a lot of challenges for them, especially with COVID-19 for the inclusive kids and normal kids. And the other questions is what you posted to me is how we put into multi-intelligency. So if I'm going to take a step back, take away multi-intelligency, in our practice curriculum, normally I'm sure that for Indonesia preschool, first is a language, Bahasa. Yeah. Secondly, you will teach the maths. Yeah. And then thirdly, will be a social emotion. But social emotion itself is a kind of theory we can talk about it. If in practical, how actually we teach is moral education. It's the moral education that I didn't mention it in the slide. Moral education is part of social emotional. How to bring the children to realize their interpersonal and intrapersonal skill. How they talk to the friend, how to talk to the sibling, how to communicate with the parents. That is moral education. They come into the pictures. In the curriculum itself, we put moral education. But when we assess the children, we assess the internal and as internal intrapersonal skill. So become multi-intelligency there. Yeah. And the other one, fine motor, gross motor. We also have to teach, but actually it's a physical. Yeah. Some curriculum, they don't put it as fine of gross motor skill. They don't put it. But what we put it, we can embed it or integrate in the arts, in the physical. Arts, we have pain, sensory, children touch. Some children don't like sticky hand, Play-Doh. So glue, that is where the fine motor skill, gross motor skill come in. You ask them to jump. Some kids just, I have a class of the kids that today I talked to my the other teachers. Selected music. When the music he liked, he would jump. When the music he don't like, he would just sit there and look at the friend dancing. But this is theory we talk about physical. In the curriculum itself, we call physical outdoor play. Yeah. And we put in, we put arts. But and the objective and goal we want to meet, we must say fine motor skill or gross motor skill. There is a planning for the teachers to see what is the goal, what is the objective. Yeah. Yes. Then the number, it comes to manipulative. Because for the young three children, three, two, three, four, we do not teach them plus and minus. Or we teach them shapes, color, yeah, number words. So that is only not like every day you look at the colors, shapes, triangle, rectangle. It's very boring to them. So what we embedded is or integrate with block play, manipulative play. That is where the multi-intelligency comes as a whole. I hope I answer your questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Ya, buat yang lain, penjelasannya tadi bahwa di Singapura tidak mengajarkan menjumlah, ya, menjumlah, tapi yang dikenalkan di matematika itu adalah bentuk, geometri, kemudian warna, dan mengenalkan angka. Ya, Ibu Eti.
Yes. Jadi, untuk pertanyaan yang pertama tadi juga disebutkan tentang strategi, ya. Jadi di Singapura itu hampir semua orang tua memiliki komputer, kalaupun tidak mereka mempunyai HP gitu kan, smartphone. Dan untuk koneksi internet tidak begitu masalah karena internet ada di mana-mana. Jadi luar biasa diberikan banyak fasilitas. Dan kemudian ya tetap orang tua juga pasti semua dimanapun berada pasti adanya COVID ini banyak berubah dan banyak tantangan, challenge ya yang dihadapi. Tetapi di sana mereka semacam saling membantu ya, orang tua terutama, saudara juga tidak bisa dijadikan bantuan dalam misalnya untuk adiknya yang masih berusia dini untuk membantu melihat pekerjaannya atau melihat pembelajarannya ya selama online. Jadi banyak sekali sih tantangan, khususnya ada anak yang tipe yang hiperaktif, diaktif kalau sedang bermain role play dengan anak-anaknya, namun dengan pembelajaran online ini kan sangat berbeda ya dengan apa yang dirasakan. Jadi memang butuh adaptasi. Ada juga anak yang sangat pemalu kalau depan Zoom, padahal saat di kelas dia sangat hiperaktif atau sangat tol aktif, sangat cerewet lah istilahnya kita bilang begitu ya. Jadi memang banyak perubahan, beradaptasi, tetapi pentingnya seorang guru adalah mengetahui, mengidentifikasi, oh ada perubahan, oh harus saya bantu ini, dan komunikasi dengan orang tua pastinya. Well, thank you.
And yeah, responsive and creative.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Sekarang kita berikan, I will invite the participant to ask question.
Yeah, sure.
Pada ini partisipan yang ingin bertanya, silakan.
If it's in Malay, I can try to understand. Otherwise, I ask you to translate. Don't feel like to speak English. I get them to speak Malay. I can try to understand.
Ya, boleh pakai bahasa Indonesia. Nanti ada Ibu Eti yang translate. Silakan yang mau bertanya.
Ini dalam bahasa Indonesia tidak masalah. Silakan. Ini bebas. Silakan yang di YouTube juga, kalau ada yang ingin bertanya, silakan ditulis pertanyaannya di chat. Nanti saya akan lihat. Silakan bunda-bunda, saya lihat ada bunda-bunda, dan kemudian mahasiswa-mahasiswa semua. Silakan bertanya di dalam bahasa Indonesia juga. Silakan. Oke, oh ada ini yang bertanya. Aprilia Usman ya, Bu, saya ingin tahu bagaimana pengajaran tentang geometri pada anak yang susah diajak belajar. Maksudnya anak yang ketergantungan dengan teknologi smartphone ya. Oke, okay. I will translate for you, Cindy. There's one question from our student. He asked about how we are going to teach this chef, as you mentioned before, if we encounter with children who are so addictive to technology, so they don't really interested to learning safe or learning things like that.
All right, that is a key question. In my previous school, International Childhood, we also use a lot of technology to conduct afternoon lesson. I can understand that that is a very challenge. What we can do is that in some of the apps in the technology, we do use the shape, but what the attractive for the children when it come about technology is no different from the physical is train. What is a train like? The shape of the train. Rectangle, on the top, square, triangle, and how the car look like, how the boat. So from the technology itself, you can draw, we use a sample of model boat, train. Then from there, you can draw the boat, the train itself, you have one rectangle, two rectangle, on the top is a square. There is a smoke coming up. So that is where from technology itself, you use the object that they can see from technology and explain to them what can you see the shape or geometry itself. They still can learn.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Cindy.
No
Jadi,
problem.
Jawabannya dari pertanyaan Aprilia Usman itu bahwa bagaimana cara kita mengajarkan bentuk pada anak yang tertarik dengan teknologi. Di Singapura itu mereka banyak menggunakan teknologi untuk pembelajaran. Jadi mereka bisa melihat misalnya ada anak-anak yang cenderung tertarik dengan teknologi. Mereka mengintegrasikan misalnya dalam aplikasi teknologi ada bentuk-bentuk seperti untuk mengenali bentuk-bentuk gitu, geometri. Jadi misalnya contohnya tadi disebutkan kayak kereta. Kereta itu bentuknya apa sih misalnya begitu. Misalnya bentuknya persegi atau bentuknya ini. Kemudian bisa digabung, misalnya persegi digabung apa di depannya, di belakangnya, kemudian itu nanti dibuat dalam bentuk kereta. Jadi tidak harus mengajarkan balok yang seperti, tapi bentuk-bentuk yang ada di sekeliling kita, misalnya ini bentuknya apa ya, ini bentuknya apa, benda-benda yang ada di sekitar kita, itu yang dijadikan pertanyaan dan diajar anak untuk membuat bersama. Jadi misalnya ada gambar atau juga menggunakan teknologi, misalnya gambar kereta atau gambar mobil yang dari video atau dari apa itu dibuatkan, misalnya mereka kemudian membuat bentuk-bentuk itu dengan balok-balok yang ada, jadi mencipta. Jadi dikombinasikan antara teknologi dan kreativitas mereka bisa membuat sendiri, misalnya begitu. Begitu ya, siapa lagi yang ingin bertanya, silakan.
Ada Bu dari saya.
Ya silakan Ibu Hanjara.
Dari saya mengenai pertanyaan tadi Bu, apakah di Singapura itu orang tua semua itu tidak merasa khawatir dengan adanya anak-anak itu belajar melalui internet ya? Karena pengalaman khusus kita di Gorontalo itu kebanyakan orang tua itu lebih khawatir terhadap anak-anaknya itu keseringan main HP terus. Terima kasih.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Cindy, one question from Hajara Ismail. She asks about whether in parents in Singapore, whether they are worried because their children maybe spend a lot of time doing with internet. Because in here, in Gorontalo, many parents, they are concerned that their children spend a lot of time using their devices with the internet and something like that. How about in Singapore?
All right. I will not answer for primary school and secondary school. Of course, they need to use that for their education part of it because a lot of the preschool and primary school, they are depending on technology. For the youngest kindergarten, it gets into that, but not all the school encourage. Because first of all, if we as a teacher school, we don't encourage, definitely we will not encourage children. Yes, some parents, they won't realize that they're worried about the technology used for the children. How as a teacher, I realize it, we realize it is that we can observe the children focusing mind is not there. When we teach, They have their view, they have their imagination there, and sometimes they will laugh themselves, and sometimes they will just play with their hand. Then their focusing mind not there. But to the parents, they do not know because the technology, handphone, iPad, is just part of the gadgets for the children to cool down at home, not disturbing them. They thought that with that will help the children to learn more. So that is where the parents don't realize it, but we as a teacher, we realize it. We are worried than the parents, honestly.
So when you say about the youngest kindergarten, what age do you mean for this?
Sometimes could be from 3 to 6.
Okay,
3-4. Yeah.
Okay, jadi jawaban dari pertanyaan Ibu Hajara bahwa di Singapura orang tua mereka tidak begitu mengkhawatirkan, justru yang banyak mengkhawatirkan itu di sekolah. Jadi beberapa sekolah itu ada yang setuju pemakaian teknologi terintegrasi dalam pembelajaran, ada juga yang masih kayak tidak begitu sepenuhnya menerima begitu, masih mengkombinasikan antara yang tidak menggunakan digital dengan yang digital. Kemudian untuk yang tersering dirasakan anak itu mereka terkadang kehilangan fokus ya. Kalau memang mempunyai orang tuanya kan di sana mungkin iPad, handphone itu bagian dari keseharian. Jadi mereka mungkin tidak semua begitu memperhatikan penggunaan teknologi. Padahal sebenarnya harusnya ada aturan atau mungkin ada batasan yang jelas berapa lama atau apa saja yang bisa digunakan. Tapi kalau untuk SD ya, SD ke atas itu mereka memang bagian dari pembelajaran. Jadi memang ya wajib digunakan. Tapi kalau untuk preschool atau untuk TK PAUD itu ada yang setuju, ada juga yang masih tidak begitu terbuka dengan adanya teknologi seperti itu ya.
Or we can make an agreement with children. Yeah. To limit yes. their using yeah. of gadget.
Yeah. Yeah, some parents I ever ask the parents, how often do you let our children to play to use iPhone gadgets? They say only on the weekend. Some say only if in the evening. But to me that if they use it on the weekdays, most of them, the children will lose focus in the daytime. So that's why I do have a child who have we can identify. So the moment we look at them not focusing, then when I talk to parents, then the parent realize that, then they stop. The moment they stop, the subsequent week, then we can see the children reaction is different. They are more focused in the class. They are more responsive to the teacher questions. That is very important. As the teachers, we need to observe the children behavior. Then again, we collaborate with the parents. What is right, what is wrong for them to use.
Yeah. Tadi disebutkan bahwa guru penting sekali untuk mengenali tanda-tanda, misalnya kalau anak berubah perilakunya atau tiba-tiba ada perubahan mendasar. Jadi misalnya kayak tadi contohkan kalau orang tuanya mungkin mengizinkan penggunaan gadget atau teknologi di malam hari, jadi mungkin anak kesulitan untuk tidur atau pada saat di sekolah ada misalnya tiba-tiba anaknya jadi mudah mengantuk atau apapun itu, maka guru harus bisa mengenali hal-hal itu, kemudian mengkomunikasikan dengan orang tua. Jadi mengetahui kenapa misalnya anaknya biasanya ceria di pagi hari, tiba-tiba saja mengantuk, lemes, apa. Nah, jadi situ ditahulah bahwa mungkin penggunaan teknologi di malam hari itu harus dikurangi, atau jangan terlalu malam sehingga tidak mempengaruhi atau tidak mengganggu aktivitas anak di pagi hari, seperti itu ya. Oke, we still need some question or how about? Ada yang masih bertanya sebelum ini? Silakan yang masih ingin bertanya dan juga yang di YouTube kalau tidak bisa.
Ada chat kayaknya itu. There's a chat from Musdalifah.
Okay, one question from Musdalifah, our student. She asked about because of pandemic, maybe the economic status of some parents is decreased, like they have some financial difficulty. Hmm. Whether this is have direct impact to the children, especially for early childhood children, maybe because the financial crisis also happening.
Yeah, we do. Honestly, we also realize it now. That is where the government come into a lot of subsidiary for the school fee. especially. So our government this year has been reviewed the school fee for next year to reduce and give a lot of subsidy for the parents so that they can only pay a minimum amount and encourage children to come to school. Yes, definitely there is an economic impact now with the COVID-19 and worse than before. However, we try our best to get the children to come to school. It's not a mandatory for kindergarten children, but the government trying to reduce the fee so that the parent affordable to send their children continue to come to school. Yes, we do have.
Okay, yeah. Thank you, Cindy. Jadi jawabannya Musdalifah yang ya, pemerintah di sana memang melihat adanya kesulitan finansial yang terjadi khususnya kepada orang tua, jadi mereka memberikan beberapa kebijakan atau bantuan, salah satunya dengan mungkin melihat kembali besaran SPP yang harus dikeluarkan oleh orang tua. Jadi dengan itu diharapkan orang tua tetap termotivasi untuk membawa anaknya ke sekolah. Jadi dengan bantuan-bantuan yang diberikan, diharapkan angka partisipasi di PAUD itu tetap sama ataupun meningkat seperti itu. Oke. Okay. Yes. Well, any more question? I think, how about in YouTube, Ibu? Is there any question from the YouTube participants? Sorry. Ya, yeah, atau yang lain di sini di chat silahkan ingin bertanya.
Ada pertanyaan. There's a questions in YouTube.
Silakan Ibu, mungkin Ibu yang boleh baca soalnya saya tidak ini akses
ke YouTube. It's from Nindi Midu. The questions is how to reduce or how to because maybe some children have addicted to gadget, so how to reduce their addicted
from limit the time.
Yeah,
we always limit the time, like for example limit 5-10 minutes, but we have an incentive to tell the children, you must do this first, then I will let you have a time to look into gadgets. So limit their time or replace with the activity upwards, creativity, toys. That is the best to do that. Because a lot of parents now, in order for gadgets, they don't have to spend money to buy toys. Toy is very expensive now. I can understand that. But in order not to get expensive, use the artwork. I always encourage children to use artwork. Drawing is just a any paper. I saw a pencil, color pencil, crayon. That is where they will use imagination. So that will help them to reduce their gadget time. Back to the step to the physical situation. That is important.
Okay, thank you. Jawabannya, Nindi, dibatasi penggunaan gadget. Kita nggak boleh apa ya, nggak boleh harus tega, jadi harus komitmen, komitmen to limit the time to reduce the addicted of gadget. Jadi walaupun anak-anak nangis sampai ngamuk atau yeah, segala macam,
kita
harus kuat untuk bisa menahan, mengurangi waktu penggunaan gadget.
Yeah.
Kemudian dialihkan dengan kegiatan-kegiatan kreatif, bisa dikasih kertas, krayon, kemudian mungkin playing Lego, playing blocks, banyak permainan kreatif yang bisa apa namanya dialihkan dari gadget. Ya.
Disibukkan ya begitu ya Bu ya.
Ya.
Okay. And well, I think it's now 5 p.m. But how about you, Bu Pupung? Whether we continue one more question or we just
if there any questions? Ada pertanyaan lagi dari Bunda, Bunda. Oh, ini masih ada satu, Nurfadila Pulumoduyo.
Okay. Oh yes. One question for Nurfadila. She asked about how we go in this pandemic situation, how we going to put children to be more independent, and what kind of values that they need yeah. to understand during it, this
characters.
Yeah, this is very good because a lot of children need to be independent. So what independently we use a moral education. First thing, you need to bring in moral education. Read a storybook about how to be independent, how to be helping hand, how to be shared. And the other thing for me to teach a children be more independent is to put them back to responsible. They need to do their own work. You need to take your own water bottle. You need to take your own bag. You need to put your bag and water bottle in your place when you go to school. When you finish your work, writing, coloring, you need to put back the material you use at home. Parents have to restart learning to hands off by not doing a lot of work for them. So in the one word is that give them responsibility. Their actions, as I always develop my kids, is that you spray the water on the table, you need to clean it up. That is your responsibility. The moment you tell them it's your responsibility, children will be alert. Oh, I need to do. That is a very tricky. But I have been using that myself with all my kids, 16 of them. Then they realize that in order to their responsibility, they will not mess around any table. They will not dirty the place. They know every morning they come and put the thing nicely. That naturally would help them to develop independently. Again, have to work with the parents because the parents need to know what we do in school. They also need to apply at home. Otherwise, it would defeat the purpose. Have a grandmother will do it for them, have a helper do it for them. That is a lot of issue that when I see that, especially for the international school, those are the migrants' children, foreign children, they have a helper in Singapore. Everything they do for them. But in the local kids, they have grandparents. So one normally I would just tell them, your grandparents is not your mate, not your helper. You need to do yourself. So throw it back to them. Then they will take it. Responsibility, your action. They will alert. It's help.
Okay. Ya, jadi jawaban dari pertanyaannya bahwa dimulai dengan mengajarkan pendidikan moral. Mulai dengan membacakan cerita, mulai dengan membuat si anak bertanggung jawab atas apa yang dia lakukan. Misalnya mereka mulai datang ke sekolah dengan menyimpan sendiri sepatunya, merapikan sendiri tasnya, menyimpan dengan baik. Kemudian misalnya kalau anak menumpahkan misalnya minumannya, ya kasih kesempatan anak untuk merapikan sendiri, melap sendiri. Jadi dengan seperti itu, anak sadar bahwa, oh saya harus jadi mandiri dengan bertanggung jawab. Misalnya saya tidak boleh sembarangan asal menyimpan tas atau asal menyimpan sepatu karena saya akan sendiri merapikannya. Jadi mending dengan sebelumnya dirapikan memang, jadi tidak akan bekerja dua kali. Dan selain itu bahwa orang tua juga harus sepakat dengan guru. Jadi misalnya orang tua jangan juga terlalu banyak membantu apa yang anak bisa lakukan sendiri misalnya. Jadi apa yang terjadi di sekolah harusnya seirama dengan apa yang terjadi di rumah, karena di rumah biasanya mungkin ada nenek yang membantu, ada tante yang membantu, ada kakak yang membantu, jadi anak terbiasa, jadi susah untuk mandiri. Jadi memang guru harus bisa mengidentifikasi itu dan mengkomunikasikannya. Kemudian dengan seperti ini anak bisa sadar dan bisa menjadi lebih mandiri, khususnya selama kesehariannya begitu. Atau Ibu Pupung mau menambahkan, silahkan. Maybe Ibu Pupung want to add some explanation.
Yeah. I think it's a must that collaborations not only on during the pandemic of COVID-19 but every day. Teachers and parents and also all the family members must collaboration, have a collaborative activities. So the program in school and at home can, you know, it's integrate activities between school and home, not just only in pandemic, but also every day. That's all, maybe.
Yeah. All right. Well. A lot of questions we have answered.
Thank you.
And I think no more questions so far. Jadi sudah banyak pertanyaan yang dijawab ya, dan tidak ada lagi pertanyaan yang ingin diajukan. And yes, I think they are already understand.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Miss Cindy Lim.
Yeah, some conclusion or maybe your opinion about today's webinar. We are so glad to have you. How what do you expect?
I feel it's a good session that I can share with you, as long as feel free to ask. It's a good collaboration to my knowledge and share with your country. And also maybe next time it's free for you to share your over there, then for me to how to input for that. Then we'll see the gap in between. That will be help to collaboration from the teachers over there and students over there. Then I will just add on for that to make it the gap closer in between. Yeah, just rather than I keep saying what over here. Yeah,
or maybe
today's session will have you.
Yeah, or maybe I will arrange a schedule for you to teach in our department.
Yes, I'm glad to do that. So I do as I
propose.
Yeah, yes, that would be wonderful. We can exchange and sharing what we what happened in our own context. I think
Yeah.
In Singapore, what happened in Indonesia, especially in Gorontalo, and I think that's really a wonderful collaboration going to be.
Yes.
Because this is the revolution of 4.0, so we need collaboration.
Together.
Communication.
Yeah. Every country for the education has been changing now. Even in Singapore, we will not know next year because of the COVID-19. We will not know what will change. Also,
Thank you very much, Cindy.
Welcome.
Really, very
stay safe and take care of you.
Afternoon. Okay, not only we get a lot of insights, especially students, they are more brave to be, maybe one day they're going to be a kindergarten teacher tour in Malaysia. Yeah, jadi mungkin kalian nanti bisa menjadi guru PAUD di Singapura, guru PAUD.
Amin.
Jadi ini step pertama.
Yeah, we do have Indonesia preschool.
Jangan cuma jadi di lokal. Kenapa tidak kerja di negara maju, di negara tetangga? Jadi we have to be brave and be
brave, creative. Responsive, and creative.
We want to start this webinar and also encourage us to go beyond what we expect ourselves.
Yes.
Yeah. Jadi, thank you so much, Cindy.
No problem. Welcome. Enjoy. Yep. Take care all. Okay, bye.
Bye.
And that's all for today webinar. And I'm so glad.
Okay. All right. Bye.
Bye. Thank you. Ya, buat yang lain. Masih ada di sini? Okay. Yang lain masih ada di sini mahasiswa? Kayaknya Cindy udah keluar.
Iya, Cindy udah keluar. Koneksi saya tadi sempat ini ya.
Iya, berhenti. Langsung freeze.
Sorry. Ini mungkin momen awal ya, Bu, buat kita untuk ke depan lebih global, berpikirnya global.
Tadi kan saya udah propose.
Iya. Mungkin saja diatur.
Siapa tahu, semester depan bisa dijadwalkan. Ya, siapa tahu nanti ada yang kecomot 1-2 mahasiswa bisa ke Singapura.
Ya, bisa.
Amin. Ini Bu, amin.
Iya, kan apa namanya? Ini usaha supaya